So these three are my thoughts. And I suspect it's not this kind of event, but can I just start by asking who in the room thinks that the Conservative Party here, and we have to remember Brexit is really a Conservative Party project, who in the audience thinks that the Conservative Party has really got to grips with the central issue that divides it around Brexit? Does it want to remain close to the EU, or does it want to be a bold and buccaneering trading nation with a very liberal, in a not nice sense, a very liberal regulatory environment? Does anyone here think the Conservative Party has really resolved that issue at this stage? Okay, we have one hand raised for a no. Neither do I, and that's a really important point to start with, because we need to remember the Conservative Party's had 21 months since the referendum to resolve that issue. And I don't have a sense that there's anybody in the room that it's any nearer now than it was 21 months ago to resolving that fundamental question. So if they had 21 months and they haven't really made any progress, I ask rhetorically, what's going to change before October of this year? And what's going to change in the 5 or 10 or 20 years following October of this year? For so long as the Conservative Party remains in existence, it will, I believe, continue to be split in exactly the way that it is now. And so there will be no majority possible for either of those two visions of what the United Kingdom looks like after Brexit. Now, this may sound bad, but I think it's cause for some optimism. Because I think what happens, and I speak to people across the channel who also think this, you probably have better contacts than mine, but I think that what happens is that the Conservative Party eventually gets bored. It gets bored with arguing with itself. It gets bored with arguing with people making a nuisance of themselves like me. I'm always litigating the courts, as of course today, I'm in the course of the next week, trying to make life difficult. So I think what happens is that we find ourselves in a transitional period, that's now common ground, that transitional period will extend beyond the general election, and the new regime that comes in, the new government that comes in, whatever that government is, post-general election, will think to itself, why on earth do I want to subvert my domestic and foreign policy agenda to fighting a battle that was from 5 years ago or more, and is insoluble? And if it's a Labour government, they will certainly think, why on earth should I fix the problems of the Conservative Party? What's in it for me? And so this transitional period, I believe, will continue and continue. And eventually, we will contemplate the possibility that we either become an EFTA state and join the EEA, or we become a fully fledged voting, participating member of the European Union again. So, and there are various legal mechanics by which this might happen. It might be an association agreement, it might just be a transitional period, but the machinery doesn't really matter, because what is driving this is the politics, and what is driving the politics is that there is no majority for any vision of Brexit. So the world that I see is us being shuffled into this little anteroom, call it what you like, call it the transitional period or implementation period or association period, it matters not, whilst we get even more bored with fighting about Brexit. And so there's quite a lot of jockeying for position around what the terms of that transitional period should look like. And I believe, at least, that the smarter analysts are focusing a lot of attention on getting that implementation period right. Not because they care especially about what happens in the two-year or the 18-month time frame of the transitional period, but because they are preparing for that transitional period to be the model for the future relationship or the medium term between the United Kingdom and the EU. And so there's a new draft withdrawal agreement published by the EU today. And the most interesting bit in it, if you follow my analysis, is part four, which deals with the transition period. With that very lengthy, preliminary remarks, let me now come to address what all of that analysis means if you are you, if you are an EU citizen, a Greek citizen, living in the United Kingdom. What does it mean for you post-Brexit? Well, the good news is that the transition period basically preserves all bar one of the rights that you presently enjoy in the United Kingdom. You continue to have access to the Court of Justice to protect your rights. You'll continue to have the right to live here and to move here. Your rights won't be restricted in any material respect, bar one. And that material respect is this. You will lose your rights to vote in European parliamentary elections. And this is gossip, it's amusing gossip, it's interesting gossip, but it is only gossip. And what I'm told is that it's the United Kingdom insisting on that. Of course, it will be reciprocated for UK citizens living in the EU. The United Kingdom is insisting on that because it fears that the European Parliament elections, were they to be held whilst we were in the transitional period, would turn into a proxy second referendum. And pro-Europe MP candidates will sweep the board, and such democratic legitimacy as the Brexit project continues to possess will disappear. So what I hear, I say it's gossip, is that some mischief makers on the other side of the channel are pushing quite hard for voting rights to be retained in the transitional period. And they're being encouraged to do so by mischief makers here. So, endless transitional period from the perspective of an EU citizen living in the UK, that's all right, actually. It's not profoundly different. It means that the United Kingdom can cause less trouble when it comes to the development of the broader European project. And of course, I don't need to tell any Greek citizens that one of the problems with the EU is that it is it's either too integrated or not integrated enough. If that project is to be progressed, it might be quite a good idea if the United Kingdom were stopped from sitting at the voting table for a period of time. So that's my base case. Things continue much as they are. What happens if that theory is wrong? I have a fallback. So one of the pieces of litigation I've been pursuing is a case that asserts that UK citizens have the right under Article 20 to retain their EU citizenship post-Brexit. So Article 20, which is the provision, I think, stemming from the Maastricht Treaty that creates EU citizenship, says that EU citizenship is a separate thing, a meaningfully separate thing from member state citizenship. And I don't understand how it can be meaningfully separate if the consequence of the loss of your member state citizenship is automatically the loss of your EU citizenship. That argument seems to me to be EU citizenship completely parasitic on member state citizenship and without any that's a great concern to me, because I will lose my Eastern citizenship, my children will lose their Eastern citizenship, and that troubles me greatly. Why is that of interest to you? The answer to that question, I think, is this. One of the core guiding principles in the negotiations is the principle of reciprocity. In other words, everything that is given to or done to the citizens on one side of the negotiating table shall also be given to or done to citizens on the other side of the negotiating table. Now, European law cannot give you rights in the United Kingdom after Brexit. The whole point of Brexit is that we're escaping the evil grasp of the EU equivalent. But what EU law cannot give you, your politicians, my negotiating partners, may insist upon political discussions. So if it were the case today that we knew that I would not lose my EU citizenship if the United Kingdom leaves the EU. I believe the EU negotiating side would be asserting, as a matter of political necessity, that has to be reciprocated. So you would retain the right, the same rights in the UK as I would enjoy in the EU. Now, that's hypothesis piled on hypothesis. And the starting hypothesis is that the Court of Justice decides that EU citizenship is meaningfully separate from national citizenship. And then the next hypothesis, an important one, this is the last point I make, is that it finds out, you'll find out soon enough, so you find out before the withdrawal agreement is concluded. Because if the withdrawal agreement is concluded, then there's no opportunity for politics to get, for EU citizens resident in the UK, what EU law cannot give to them. So if I'm wrong about the transitional period, that is one route to the preservation of your existing rights. Final point I want to make is this. You all have read those dreadful stories in the newspapers. Some of you may directly have experienced what those dreadful stories in the newspapers are about, namely the increasingly hostile and aggressive attitude of the Home Office to foreign nationals, including EU nationals, resident in the United Kingdom. That is the political agenda of this regrettable government. The way in which you tackle that political agenda, I believe, is by raising the political cost of pursuing that agenda. And what that looks like in practice, I believe, is campaigning and litigating as a way of campaigning against that unfair, unkind, and really quite deeply un-British treatment of our friends and our colleagues and our neighbours and our partners with whom we have lived happily for decades. I do not think that the British people will buy that treatment from the Home Office, and I think there is a fight there to be won. So that was all I was just saying.
So thank you very much. I think we have just about 10 minutes before you have to leave, so we can take some questions. Let me start a very short discussion by a question of my own. I can imagine that in an event of, if you want, a hard Brexit, still the people who have established, you know, some rights here, the Europeans who established some rights here, will be able to get citizenship or permanent residence, so that may not be an issue. But in the event where we do not have a perfect single market, and maybe without migration, I'm not saying that there will be full capital controls, but then moving capital, money, may become much more problematic. Do you think that this may be a problem for people who have accumulated somewhere in both places?
Well, we're all in an interesting position, aren't we? Because one of
last Monday on the Westminster Council. I'm a European citizen from Berlin, and they had a discussion. They're all welcome for our EU people, and they're most welcome. Then I asked the question, as I have a European passport, I can vote in the local election, but I couldn't vote for in or out. And I said, so many other people couldn't do that. Now, shush, that is political. We can't answer that. That was the answer applied to that. Quite a bit later on, when I spoke to other people, there were quite a few Romanians on the board in the council meeting. And a lot of questions have been asked, but unfortunately, they are working on lots of things and they couldn't answer a lot of things. One thing that you say about the Home Office, that was not very fair to European citizens. There was a very nice young man. He tried to have a British passport, and twice he was refused. When he went up to the panel to find out why, couldn't answer either way. So it was a very, all the people from the EU were very disgruntled about the same.
I think one of the things that's happening is that we haven't really taken this stuff sufficiently seriously. I'm not sure how to do that.
It's the other microphone.
It's that one, okay. And one of the difficulties that we have is that the Home Office is doing an awful lot that we don't know about. It's not in the media, the government is delivering a political, a rather unattractive, and I personally think rather xenophobic agenda without much political cost. I very much hope that we will, be able to bring that issue to the top of the political agenda in the United Kingdom. One of the things that I'm doing at the moment is I'm trying to get together a fighting fund to bring a series of high-profile cases challenging Home Office immigration decisions in relation to those who are not UK citizens. Not because I'm strategically interested in the results of those individual cases, but because I think it's a very, very good way to push the issue up the political agenda to increase the political cost for the government behaving in the way in which it does.
You presented the current situation as a split in the Conservative Party, but would you not agree that it is also, to some extent, a split in the Labour Party, with at least two MPs, Frankfield and Kate Hooley, being Brexiteers, and also a split with Labour Party voters, especially in the north of England. And therefore, it's a bit of a split, would you not say, between people in the country, England, especially outside the metropolitan centres, and members of Parliament?
I mean, there are certainly some all of those points are fair. Of course, if you're just about managing to stay in government, in minority government, it's your internal psychogram that is writing the history books of tomorrow for the United Kingdom. And what's happening in the Labour Party is not of primary concern. Where I think your point is especially well made is that if the Labour Party was able to come out for continued membership of the single market, I think they could deliver that result, because the Conservative Party, those at least of it on the sort of social European model side of the Brexit argument, have a wing, and that wing is sufficiently big that if they were to vote with the Labour Party, the government would So certainly one of the things that I try to do in my campaign is to put pressure on the Labour Party to increase the political cost of the Labour Party of holding the line that it does. Because I think if the Labour Party had come out of the single market, that's where we would, I believe, undoubtedly end up. But we need to get there. The other point I'd make, I think very quickly, is that those issues that you attribute to people like Kate Hurley are also, of course, present to a very less extent in the Leader's office. But I'm not too pessimistic about that, because my sense is very much that Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell, if faced with a choice between power or Brexit, will certainly choose power. Whereas the